This show is designed to really glorify Christ. Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. Welcome to Testimonies of Jesus. I'm your host, C.C. Baker. I am here on the set with a wonderful guest, my wife, Beverly. Hey, Beverly.
Hi, Clint.
How are you doing?
Fine.
I'm glad you joined us today. We are going to be talking about deliverance, and we're going to be coming from the book of Acts 19. This is a scripture we've talked about quite a bit, Acts 19:11. We've had a lot of healing and deliverance testimonies through this. But Acts 19:11-12, it said, God wrought special miracles by the hands of Paul. And it says, so that from his body were brought into the sick handkerchiefs or aprons, and the diseases departed from them, and the evil spirits went out of them. We've been in the ministry for a little while, and we've seen all kind of healing and deliverance miracles. I want to specifically talk about that verse right there, Acts 19:11-12. Just tell me a little bit about some of the things you've eyewitnessed of being in the ministry with, the prayer cloths. And we know the anointing of the Holy Spirit is what's in those cloths or whatever objects here. But what kind of things have you seen over the years? Just a couple things.
Well, one thing that comes to mind right now is the time that someone from out of the state called and asked for prayer for someone that was in the hospital and asked us to pray for them. And you said that you would take a prayer cloth that you had prayed over and anoint it from hours of praying and seeking the Lord about bringing about deliverance for those people that would receive those cloths. And you took the picture of the individual. You asked him to send you a picture.
Mm-hmm.
And you took the picture of the individual, and of course you took and ran a copy of it, and you took that prayer cloth and you wrapped the individual's picture up in it, and then you placed it in your Bible and you began to pray, and literally within hours there was a total different case as far as in a positive light for the individual.
Right. If you're watching right now, we're coming from Acts 19:11-12. We're talking about the presence of God, the power of God. In Acts 19:11-12, again, key in this, it said, God wrought special miracles by the hands of Paul. So we recognize the fact God is doing the work. He's just using man as a vehicle here. And again, a special guest, my lovely wife, Beverly Baker, she's on the set. She's given an eyewitness account. There was a situation, and this is what I'm thinking you're referring to, is a woman who was burned.
That's
right. She was a burn victim. This particular woman, the doctors gave her pretty much through the night. They didn't expect her to live. She had a reaction, of course, you know, you're in that kind of situation. And her sons, and this is the interesting thing, her sons were not born again. I got this referral through someone, to send this out. Actually, it was my brother that actually sent this request. But the issue with this particular case was that people were not born again, but they believed in prayer. And we didn't have a lot of time because, again, they said maybe by tomorrow, you know, she would be passed away. And the doctors looked, and it was some type of infection, of course, that happens in burn victims, that set up, and it was deadly at that point. And I'm saying this with someone right now. This is not about promoting man. The show is Testimonies of Jesus. The same thing Jesus did then, he's still doing today. Jesus is still a healer. You know, we're talking about there's nothing else they could do at this point. But the only thing, as I was in prayer, the Lord said, get a picture. Now, I'm saying this because there's no distance in the spirit. From now, from where I'm sitting now to where you are in your home, the same Holy Spirit can go through the camera. The anointing is captured on the tape, and you might be watching this now live, or you could be watching it another day. The same Holy Spirit will still move later. And this, it was very powerful. This woman, of course, the doctors come the next day and say, we don't understand this. You know, we've not seen anything like this. We just knew that she was going to die, and it was my prayer shawl. That's what, you know, I took the picture, put the picture in the prayer shawl, and the prayer shawl is something that, you know, a lot of ministers use the prayer shawl. It's like the Hebrew type prayer shawl, but it's just hours of praying and spending time with God, and it's God's presence We're talking about God's presence now. This is the whole theme of Acts 19, 11, and 12. It's God's presence being captured into the prayer cloths, into the aprons. So the presence of God not only heals, but it also delivers. Talk about a time also, you might, that situation, a woman was healed, by the way. You know, God restored her. She came, walked back on her own power a little while later, and God did that as a testimony to her sons, again, who didn't know Christ or anything like that. So here's someone who didn't know Christ, but they believed that God could. So I tell people Jesus can heal anybody. It doesn't matter if you're born again or not born again, he can still heal. But tell us about a time where you've experienced yourself personally, where God's power and presence, you felt his presence come in and touch your body and you get a healing in that way.
I have several times that's happened to me, of course. When I first met you, before we got married, which was back maybe around 1989, and I had something going on inside of my body mm-hmm. at the time, and I got a bad report from the gynecologist.
Mm-hmm.
And back then, my faith was not where it is today, but instead of going in and letting them speak something over me, I didn't go back.
Mm-hmm.
And I was afraid, and they told me what they saw, and I came to you and I said, my mother used to pray over me, and she would put anointing oil on me and pray for me, and I want to ask you to pray for me.
Mm-hmm.
And at that particular time, you did, and you took some olive oil and prayed over it and prayed for me and laid your hands on my stomach and prayed for me. And at that moment, I said, I believe and I received. And I didn't go back to verify anything because, again, like I said, I was afraid.
Mm-hmm.
And we later got married in 1991.
Mm-hmm.
And then we had our first child in 1994. And in 1994, they verified that I had a clean bill of health.
Yes.
So I know that God did it.
Yes.
And that was the steps that I took to go about it. But that's one example that I can tell you
correct.
That comes to mind.
You know, I remember that so well. Something I want to bring out to viewers that's watching this right now, you know, again, we were from two different backgrounds. She was Seventh-day Adventist, I was Baptist, and, you know, we're just Christians and believe in God, of course, now. We're not focused on denomination. But I remember her background being her mother instilled prayer, okay?
Yes,
she instilled prayer, and that's important that, you know, you had that background. How important just growing up in the house with your mom, you know, her, you know, with your brothers and all, just those examples of anointing with oil and stuff like that. How did that affect you now? You know, you're looking back, because before you answer that, Paul told Timothy that he recognized that he had the same faith as his mother and his grandmother. In other words, they were people of faith. They were people that exercised the word of God. And as a result of that, Timothy had that same like precious faith. So how important, what did that play on your faith today in receiving healing?
Interestingly enough, it played a big impact.
Mm-hmm.
I praise God for this because as I recall now, I remember one time being in the third grade and having a stomach ache.
Mm.
And I told my mother that my stomach was hurting, and she said, well, okay, I'm going to pray for you.
Mm-hmm.
And she wasn't the type of mother that ran to the doctor as soon as you told her you didn't feel well.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't come from that type of background.
Mm-hmm.
And we weren't against doctors or anything, because mm-hmm. certainly we had seen them before.
Mm-hmm.
We went for our checkups and our shots and immunizations and so forth, but we just weren't in there just because you had a cough or your throat was hurting.
Mm-hmm.
I don't remember being a sickly child, and came from a line where she did believe that if somebody caught a flu
mm-hmm.
or got a cold or measles or whatever, just play with them,
mm-hmm.
the other siblings, so we could all get it at the same time.
Mm-hmm.
But I remember telling her my stomach was hurting that particular day. And she said, okay, well, I'm going to pray for you. And I thought she was going to give me Pepto-Bismol or something, because we did have those types of things, cough syrup and Pepto-Bismol and
mm-hmm.
different things for your aches and so forth. But
right.
this particular day, she told me she would pray for me,
mm-hmm.
and she came into the room where I was, and she took some oil, and this was my very first encounter with her doing that for me and to
mm-hmm.
me, but I remember it, and I was laying in the bed, and she laid her hands on me, and she prayed in Jesus' name that he would touch me and heal me. And mm-hmm. I really, literally felt the pain leave.
Mm-hmm.
And I didn't want to tell her because I didn't want to go to school the next day. But I did receive a healing.
Mm-hmm.
And she asked me later, did I feel better? And I said that I did. And truly, I did. Mm-hmm. And I really felt the power of God move on me.
Mm-hmm.
And then later, you know, as I went through life as a child, oftentimes she would tell me she would pray for me. And I had faith to believe that she prayed for me, that it was going to get better, whatever the situation was.
Mm-hmm.
So it played a very big impact on me. And later on, I witnessed my mother being a strong prayer warrior herself. She was always praying for someone,
mm-hmm.
always praying with someone,
mm-hmm.
and always praying herself.
Mm-hmm.
And she had a rule in our house that if she didn't answer the door, after you knocked on the door, that, you know, we knew that she was okay. And especially she would tell you she was going to prayer. And you might forget, because she'd be back there a while.
Mm-hmm.
And you go back there and knock on the door. And she told us, if I close this door and I don't answer, don't come in and don't keep knocking on the door, because when I come out, I'm going to give you a spanking,
mm-hmm.
because I told you not to disturb me.
Mm-hmm.
So at that rate, one day we went to the door and we knocked on the door because I think we were hungry. We wanted something to eat. And sure enough, she didn't answer. And I made the mistake of knocking again.
Mm-hmm.
Forgetting what she had said because I was wanting to eat.
Mm-hmm.
And she didn't say anything. It was like the stillness just went over the room.
Mm-hmm.
And so I backed away from the door and I thought, oh, mercy. You know, so I went away and she came out and she talked to us about it and told me that she was in the room praying. And fortunately, I didn't get a spanking. And she talked to me. But that's something I used to see her do all the time, was go back to the room and pray. And she would not answer the phone. She wouldn't answer us. Unless it was an emergency, she mm-hmm. said, do not disturb me, do not come to the store. And she was very adamant about that. And I can honestly tell you that she did not move from that. I mean, you knocked on the door, you beat on the door. We could be in the front hollering, screaming, acting a fool. And she did not move. When she came out, she handled it.
Let's touch on that a minute. So she reverenced God.
Yes, she did.
Okay, this is what this generation has lost, reverence for God. You know, often God would show up. Verse Acts 19, 11, and 12, this is Paul the Apostle. He's ministering, and I've used this as a theme often. He's ministering the Word of God. He's ministering under the Holy Spirit's power. But there's a certain reverence.
Yes.
Okay. Reverence brings God on the scene.
Yes,
that's what it actually does. So there's a lot of people you may be watching now, and you might have lost some reverence. In other words, you can't, God won't compete for your attention. This is what we're really saying. When we talk about reverence, we give God the respect above anything else. You know, today, the cell phones.
That's right.
Okay, the cell phones distract quite a bit. And often we'll tune in to people and we're not focused on God. So you may be watching right now and you need a healing in your body. You need God to show up. Because we're talking about the very presence of God.
Yes.
We're talking about God's presence coming in and touching. Now, from what you shared a minute ago, this played a key component is prayer.
Yes.
Your mother prayed. She shut the door. She went in prayer. She let you know up front, don't disturb. So in other words, she set the atmosphere. So God is a God that he meets with you when you make it intimate.
That's
okay.
Right.
Somebody may be watching me right now, and you're wanting God to show up like what we're talking about, but you have to make an atmosphere for God to show up like this. I do that often, honey, because you know, in the night, sometimes I'm up in the night in prayer, or I go away and I don't need to talk at this point or whatever. That's very key. I've learned that. People have asked me, what's the key? What's the secret? The secret is just you and God. It's an attitude. It's a heart attitude. I recognize we don't have an ounce of healing power. Okay, it's Jesus. Jesus is doing the healing. But you have to learn to respect. There are times people are talking to me and the Lord is starting to speak, and I'll leave their presence to make sure I hear what God has to say. God has to be first. You know, and the Bible says, seek ye first the kingdom of God and all his righteousness. And then it says all these things will be added. He's talking on the natural about provision and anything else we need. But it's a key thing. To put God first. Now, I want to go just a minute and touch on one other thing. We're talking about prayer. Tell me some situations, and again, I know you've experienced healing, you've seen healings.
Yes.
We've seen so many miraculous healings. Let's talk about, we had a neighbor one time, they had a ear situation, They came to you, you'd known them, we'd known them, we were neighbors. But they had a corroded eardrum, and the eardrum was causing a brain issue that was very life-threatening. Talk to the viewers about that condition and what happened.
Well, what happened is she was of another nationality, and it was difficult to understand her dialect at times because she spoke broken English.
Mm-hmm.
And some days it was worse than others, and so you really had to be attentive to her to hear what she was saying, even in what she thought she was saying in English, and a lot of times it just, you couldn't understand it.
Mm-hmm.
But she did know God, and she was a Christian, and she and I had developed a close relationship, and we would get together sometimes and just share in the Word, and it was things that I was teaching her as far as her learning, as far as understanding the English language.
Mm-hmm.
But she knew us to be Christians, and she knew you were a pastor.
Mm-hmm.
At that time, you were a minister.
Mm-hmm.
And she was very serious about God and the things of God, and she was a prayer warrior.
Mm-hmm.
And she believed in prayer. And she started having some trouble with her ear.
Mm-hmm.
And she came to us and asked us to pray for her because basically the doctors told there was nothing they could do for her. And that this corrosion in her eardrum was so bad that it was going to cause brain damage.
Right. The issue, as I understand it, recalling it, the eardrum corrosion was already at the brain, affecting the brain, and they were going to do emergency surgery. That's what I was in on. I was at home in the back, and she came over to talk to you up front.
She asked if she could talk to us,
right.
And she wanted to get prayer. She didn't wait, and I remember that you did pray for her, and she went back to the doctor.
Mm-hmm.
And when she went back to the doctor, it was a total reverse of what the diagnosis had been before. God had healed her.
Yeah, let's give some details to people that's watching. She had already been to the doctor, so I just want to go on record. She had x-rays. They'd shown the corrosion in the ear going to the brain, so it was a life-threatening situation. They had scheduled emergency surgery, as I recall. Is that correct? They had scheduled emergency surgery to come go ahead and try to correct the issue, but she had to go back for some other testing.
Mm-hmm.
Or something before this took place. And she was married and had a child. But when when they did the first x-rays, they showed all the damage. She goes back. This is after we prayed. Okay, when we prayed, I remember a simple prayer. Nothing long. We had some anointing oil. We put some anointing oil. We prayed, in Jesus' name, laid hands on her and prayed. I felt nothing. You know, just like there are times that we pray and we feel the presence of God, we may feel the power of God. I felt nothing. We just did it in simple faith, based on the Word of God. Mark 16, they said, "They shall lay hands on the sick and they shall recover." And that's what we stood on, the Word of God, Mark 16. Laying hands on the sick. Now, she goes back to the doctor. Okay, what was the report? And if you can recall what was said and all of that at that point.
Well, the doctors were puzzled, and clearly you could see that they knew that something had happened beyond scientific proof,
mm-hmm.
Beyond medical evidence,
mm-hmm.
because
mm-hmm.
It hadn't been that long.
Mm-hmm.
I don't remember the exact time frame, but it was a quick process.
Right.
And then
as I recall, again, you can correct me if you have a detail, but this, the way it was related back to me when she came back, because when she came back to the house with her husband
she
this
did.
Time, but she came by
she
herself,
did.
And she described that she goes into the doctor's office, they do a second x-rays, they got her old x-rays on the screen, they get her new x-rays, and the doctor, back then, I guess they still sit on the little chairs, and they're rolling around and he's looking at the x-ray, but he's not saying anything to her.
Mm-hmm.
So she's starting to be alarmed at this whole thing. The doctor goes out of the room, goes back and get another set of doctors, and they all come into the room and they're looking at the x-ray again, still not saying anything to her. And eventually, after a little bit of this goes on, they finally, what happened?
And I remember,
okay.
If I remember correctly, she said Jesus did it.
Right. They say, as you look at this x-ray, you can see the corrosion to the brain, the corrosion in the ear. Now, if you look, and this is what was powerful about it, she has a brand new eardrum.
That's correct.
She has a brand new eardrum. It's like Jesus created a brand new eardrum and put in this lady's. And this was early days. We wasn't pastoring. I was an associate pastor, I think, at a church at that time. But I wasn't, you know, pastoring or counseling full time.
It would have to have been at least 20 years ago.
Mm-hmm, at least that. Mm-hmm. Now, what kind of impact, and this is for our viewers or some hearing that, because there's some people believe that the age of miracles are over. Okay, now that's a clear miracle. Now, the doctors they ask her what happened, and she says in her broken English, Jesus did it for me. I preach a prayer. This is what she says, and it's a miracle. Well, the doctors, they said, well, we don't know about the Jesus thing, but you can see it's clearly a miracle. So they didn't, of course, give credit to the Lord. But tell me how that impacted, that you remember, because you were friends with her relationship, even at home and with her husband.
The way I recall it is her husband decided mm-hmm. that he was going to change his life.
Mm-hmm.
Because of what God did for his wife.
Mm-hmm.
And surely it made a difference in their marriage mm-hmm. for him to begin to live for the Lord mm-hmm. and, you know, change his lifestyle to turn towards the things that would be pleasing before the Lord.
Mm-hmm.
And that was a big impact for her, and she was very grateful. And you could just see the joy of the Lord on her.
Mm-hmm.
And it made an impact for me, because to experience and to know what God would do for someone else, I knew that he would do it for me or anyone else that believed him in prayer.
Mm-hmm.
And it was a faith booster for me, certainly,
yes.
to say the least.
Yes.
And it and everything else that God has done in that way has continued to boost my faith.
Mm-hmm.
So I could appreciate that. And it was helpful for me at times when I had to pray about things that were hard in my own life,
mm-hmm.
whether it was with me, my family, and things that I had to do with it.
There are times that we get, and I've stressed this on some of the other broadcasts, there are times we get healing miracles, and then there's times that we get a healing, but it's a process, or we go through stages. Talk to me about times where you stood and you believe in God for a healing, let's say, and you're coming even from the book of Mark 4, the parable of the seed being sown, the seed of the word, or Luke 8, same parable, the word of God. The word of God, we know, is what God uses to heal. You know, Psalms 107 says he sent his word and healed them and delivered them from their destruction. But talk about a time where you had to, in other words, God didn't instantly heal, but he took you through a process. Talk to me a little bit about that. What did you see? What are some of the things you experienced before you got a healing in your body?
I recall the time that I had a place on my wrist
mm-hmm.
up above my radial bone,
mm-hmm.
and it was more or less like a knot, if you will,
mm-hmm.
and it was very vivid and visible. And when I first saw it, I was like, what is this?
Mm-hmm.
You know, and I began to panic, and the spirit of fear was the first thing that came to me. I was like, oh my goodness, what is this?
Mm-hmm.
And I was afraid, but I did pray, and I believed God that whatever it was, wherever it came from, that it wasn't sent by God, and
mm-hmm.
that I prayed in Jesus' name and believed God to take it off and take it away. And I began to pray, but it didn't leave right away.
Hold on. You may be watching right now, and you've got some growths on your body. You may have a tumor. You may have something that's there that shouldn't be there. You know, the verse that you stood on, I remember, is Mark 11:23.
Yes.
Okay. Mark 11:23 simply says, for verily I say unto you, that whosoever shall say unto this mountain, be thou removed, and be thou cast into the sea, and shall not doubt in his heart. And this is key. Shall not doubt in his heart. It says, but shall believe that those things which he saith shall come to pass, and he shall have whatsoever he saith. If you look at that scripture is talking about speaking to things. Mountain is something that's impossible to get rid of, okay? But you use your faith concerning Mark 11:23, and you begin to, you know, talk to this. What kind of process did you go through when you begin to use that? You know, just simple example, what did you do?
I looked at it each day and I said, I command you to dry up and go in Jesus' name. You do not belong here. This is not the way this is supposed to be. I command my body to line up according to the will and the way God created me to be in Jesus' name. And I began to speak to it every day. And at different times I would doubt and waver because it stayed there for a long time, a few months. But one day I looked down and began to speak to it, and it was gone.
Listen, you've been on set, my special guest, my beautiful wife, Beverly Baker. She's given a testimony about a growth on her hand. She's begun to speak, Mark 11:23. If you're there right now, you can, if you're born again and you Jesus Christ is your Lord, you have the same authority, the same right to speak to things that should not be. The scripture says, speak to this mountain, command it to be removed, and it shall be removed. So this is what I want to encourage you. Every day she spoke to it, there was a time frame, it just left. It was not there. She didn't have any other thing done. We have that same right to do it. Okay? We will see you the next time on the Testimonies of Jesus. Talk to you next time. God bless. Sometime I'm fasting and praying, and the Lord will tell me to pray, lay my hands and pray on the cloths. Pray for the presence of God. Pray for healing. Pray for the power and the virtue of God. And if you want to, again, at the same time when you order the book, Andrew Murray here, Divine Healing, if you want to get these, just request it. Put that in that line right there. Just say, Andrew Murray, Divine Healing, and then just put a little, another little comment, you know, give me the miracle prayer cloth. Just put that there. Again, this is not magic. I tell people this. You're not buying a miracle. It's not what you're doing. I promise you there's an anointing in this prayer cloth. God's power and presence, in other words, is transferable. This is what Paul was actually doing. The special miracles was Paul could not get every place, okay? But when the sick were present, it might have been a family member that needed this, and he would give this prayer cloth or this apron to a family member. The family member would then take that prayer cloth and lay it on the body of the sick family member. When they laid that prayer cloth on the body of the sick family member, the scripture says the disease left the body, and it said the demons left the body. God does the same thing today that he did in the Bible. And, you know, so I just want you to know that if you're in need of healing, deliverance, and we're going to have some other people on the show who also have testified to prayer cloths and divine healings. We're going to have a pastor. There's a pastor that we're going to interview and a businessman that's in his congregation who was healed from stage 4 cancer. He had so many hours to live, and it was water that was sent to them. God administered the water along with another minister, and the man was divinely healed from stage 4 cancer. Okay, so this is part of what we're going to be doing on the show. Again, we want to glorify Christ in the midst of that. It's not our power, not our ability, but it's Jesus Christ that's doing the healing.